But was it always a prerequisite from the start then that it was always going to be shot in English and Welsh, or Welsh and English, sorry?
Yes, it was. It was when I was approached about the job. Mm. The job was a very exciting prospect, but obviously a daunting prospect because it was in two languages, mm. one of which I speak,
yeah.
One of which I don't. And to be able to play the part, I needed to be able to do both.
Yeah.
So, yes, it was I was commissioned by S4C. Mm. So it was going to be showed on S4C and it was co-produced with BBC Wales. So it was for BBC Wales and for S4C. So, yes, they had two programmes really made. We shot two programmes. So if you think about it, we made 8 hours of drama,
yeah.
But eight for Welsh and eight for English. So actually it turns out we made 16 hours of drama really in a very short period of time. Mm.
Is it true, though, that you nearly gave up acting before Keeping Faith? Is that I mean, that's what I heard.
Yes, I'd imagine, like anybody who's done something for decades, mm. you know, this is all I've done, really. I mean, mm. from my second year in drama school, I was employed as an actor.
Yeah.
And I've done it since I was 20, you know. I've just mm. hit 40, and you think, oh, you know, you do something for 18, 20 years.
Yeah.
And I don't know, I had a little wobble, I guess, and okay. I thought, well, maybe I was getting frustrated with work, I was not landing the parts I wanted to do, and it all became a little bit frustrating, I think, and
yeah.
I love to work, I'm a workaholic, I love to create mm. and work and be in a company, and when I'm not, it's, I'm a little bit, I don't know, fractious, I guess, and a bit lost. So
okay.
I love to work. And, you know, I have huge responsibilities. I have children to bring up. I have a mortgage to pay. We all have to work.
Yes.
And it was just going in a way that I was kind of being slipped into these kind of roles and being auditioned for these kind of parts. And they were lovely parts and all the rest of it. But there were kind of things that I didn't feel like, you know, wouldn't doing. Keep me awake at night. And
yeah.
And you know, we all need at some point in our lives, if you're doing something for a long time, you need to be challenged again in it.
Yes.
You need to be, you know, to be checked, and you need to get an MOT on it, you know?
Yeah.
And I needed that. I needed it because I was feeling unchallenged and bored out of my absolute mind.
Yeah.
So this long and, you know, the reason why I felt like that is because I couldn't give my job up, is because I loved it so much. I do love my job so much. So yeah. when it's not working out, it becomes such distraction mm. That you think, well, maybe I need to get out of this distraction and proceed forward with something a bit more, I don't know, different.
Okay.
But you know, it keeps dragging me back in.
No, I'm glad it has. I'm glad it has, you know.
With obviously your husband, he got the part. Did you say he got the part before you, or you got the part before him?
No, I got. I would say a long time before they started auditioning the other part.
Okay.
So I was involved from the beginning, really. But I'd only seen maybe one or two scripts before they started the production team started to audition everybody else.
Yeah.
And Brad was up for a different part. And, you know, of course, you know, Brad had to get that part on his on his own merit.
Yes. Yeah.
I wouldn't have it any other way, and neither would he. So Brad auditioned a couple of times. We didn't hear anything for ages.
Okay.
And then I had an accident and ended up having emergency surgery.
Oh, okay.
Two surgeries in 2 days. And I was in hospital for a while.
Okay.
And I remember waking up from having my operation. And Brad was stood over me and he said, make sure I was okay, of course.
Yeah.
And then he said, I've got a bit of news. And I was looking at him all being
realised.
He said, I didn't get the part of Steve.
Right.
And I said, hey, you know, and I remember just being kind of a little bit, you know, I just come around from my second lot of anaesthetic. And I went, hey, you know, one door closes, another one opens.
Yes.
And he said to me, I've got the part of Evan. And I went, Jesus Christ, can somebody give me some more morphine? I literally thought I was on some sort of like bad wild night out. I was like, what's going on? And then I just fell out cold, fast asleep.
Okay.
And I woke up and he's still there and I kind of went, are you playing Evan or just dreamt that?
Oh,
right. And he went, no, they've offered me the part of Evan. So then it was a lot to kind of think about, you know,
because, yeah.
You know, we're husband and wife. And face and Evan are so different to us.
Yeah.
Couldn't wait for the challenge. I mean, I couldn't think of anyone better to do it with.
Okay.
It's a gift of a job to do with my husband.
Yeah,
and to understand everything that I'm going through with this job.
Yeah.
And the demands of it and how I've got to surrender to it.
And also the chemistry as well. I mean, my wife, when I told her that you were both married, she didn't know until I told her about an hour ago. She's like, that's why the chemistry was so good between you both when you're on the screen.
Oh, that's great. That's great. Yeah, I mean, you know, we've been together over 20 years.
Yeah.
So it's we didn't have to work at that, thank God. And that would have been awful, wouldn't it? Can you imagine a review going, it's great, but there's no chemistry between them.
Hello.
T-O-R-C-E.
Yeah.
So, and you know what? It's something really lovely and precious that when we're older and our children are older, something nice for them to keep, you know?
Yeah, it is. I mean, for me, it would be my worst bloody nightmare working with my wife. but, you know, not acting, obviously, you know.
Yeah. I'm coming some days, mind, after having, you know, some harrowing evenings to do, and he'd be sitting there, and he'd be like, hiya, love. Everything all right? I said, well, if you'd turned that bloody 5 minutes earlier, everything would be all right, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Sitting here with your feet up.
Yeah.
I've been looking for you all coming day.
I hear that you obviously you're going to be filming the second series. Is that true?
Well, we're hoping. I don't think anything's been greenlit yet, but it's all in development. And
okay.
We'd be very grateful and thankful if that was to happen. There's a lot more to tell.
Yeah, sure. You know, my wife said the same. You know, even myself, we think there's a lot more story there. So yeah.
Yeah.
So you don't enjoy the attention that fame brings you then?
Not in the slightest. I find it the part of the job that I find very difficult to process. If I can get away from not walking down any sort of red carpet, if I can get in through the back door, that's how I get in. The last, I've only been to two NTAs.
Okay.
Two of them. The two of them, the first one, I managed to go and be dropped off at the back door.
Yeah.
I went in. That's the one I was nominated for the best actress. I went through the back door because I was so nervous.
Yeah.
And then the last one I was made to go down, but I wished through. Like you probably wouldn't even have seen me. I went through like the wind. but yeah, I mean, things like that. The big kind of award nights, the big kind of event nights make me a bit of an introvert, I guess.
Okay. So that's like I say, that's the biggest misconception people could have about you is that you are, well, I suppose the biggest conception about you is that you're nothing like your characters at all than any character you've played.
I think there's bits of me and everything because I'm playing everything, so there's parts of me that come out, you know.
Always,
you know, we've all got dark pockets and I guess they get, you know, the light brought in because of the type of job I do, that you can put them into different characters and different parts of me come out that I don't know is there, you know.
Mm.
But I would say that, yeah, I think people might think that I'm a very strong, kind of vivacious kind of woman, and I hope in areas I am, but more times, you know, 9 times out of 10, I will say no thank you to an awards and no thank you to a party and no thank you to an event.
Okay.
Because I've got Chinese to eat on my couch.
That's quite funny. You sound like my wife. She goes to London a few times a week, comes home, and the last thing she wants to do is watch anything intellectual on the TV and just puts her pyjamas on. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Straightforward, man. It's a much easier, nicer life.
It is, especially when you've got kids as well, so, you know.
Oh, yeah.
You know. I mean, do you miss the theatre then? I mean, obviously, I know you've been on the stage quite a bit beforehand.
Yeah, I miss it very, very much. it's always rattling around there. I'm always been offered lovely, lovely stuff in theatre.
Yeah.
But, you know, I have a 4 and an 8-year-old. I live in Cardiff. And the thought of going away, you know, in London, in the West End, touring, is just an impossibility for me until the girls are older.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, you make sacrifices, and that's one sacrifice I've made.
Yeah.
And that's okay. You know, theatre's not going to go anywhere.
Mm.
I'm not going to go anywhere. And we will meet again at some point. And it will be something really big and really juicy. I can't wait.
Yeah, because, I mean, I was looking at your history. You know, you've got quite a career on the stage.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I've spent my life at the RSC. I learned so much.
Mm.
You know, to work at the National is such a... You walk into those places and it's there. From the moment you get tasked, you know, to the time you go into a rehearsal room, to the time you go into your dressing room, to the time you go on that stage, it's a remarkable journey for anybody to be a part of that. Theatre is magic.
Mm.
And every night you get to do something different.
Mm.
And, you know, it harps back to a little bit like doing this series in Welsh and in English.
Mm.
Whereas you would do, you know, they'd get the scene in the English or they'd get the scene in the Welsh and then they'd have to do it vice versa. And then maybe you'd do something a little bit different because you are doing it live.
Mm.
And you can't replicate something to the nymphs, you know what I mean? It needs face our world and keep the phrases very visceral, it's very raw, it's very free.
Mm.
And it needs to feel like that, you know, if at any point I have to hit the mark on that floor.
It won't give it a given time. That, yeah.
You know, it has to be real.
Mm.
So, and that's what theatre is to me, to go out there and perform, especially performing something like a classical piece. You feel like you're part of history, you know. It's very precious to feel like that.
Yeah, I mean, where did you get your passion from for the stage then? Is that always when you're from a young age, or was it something you developed later on?
I don't know, really. I guess it's something that, I mean, there was never any... We had, like, amateur dramatics in the local welfare hall at home.
Yeah.
But I didn't join that until later on, until my teens. We didn't have no GCSE drama in school or anything. Maybe once a year we put on a little Christmas play or something.
Oh, gosh, okay.
And I auditioned for National Youth Theatre Wales when I was 15.
Yeah.
And I guess that's when I started to learn about theatre, and that's when I started to read Shakespeare, and that's when I started reading Ibsen, and that's when I started reading all the classics, and
okay.
just thinking, my God, this is a world that has been closed to me, and I wish it had been opened when I was younger, but because there's so many wonderful stories and different worlds to explore, and it's so freeing to have that kind of text and not to be scared of it.
Mm.
Because, you know, Shakespeare's created a lot of our language, and yet people are so scared of Shakespeare.
Yes, yeah, very, very.
And yet, you know, we speak it every day.
Totally, yeah.
It's just a different way of thinking and tuning yourself into it in a different way. Like, I've learned Welsh, it's about tuning yourself into something very different.
Mm.
And accepting it and being patient with it, and then it starts to work.
Mm.
But the passion, I think, for... You know, Carl, I think the absolute honest truth is that I was brought up in a council flat in a council house all my life.
Okay.
On a council estate. Mm. And we had very little. We had a lot of love. And we had a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And what we had a lot of was movies. And for a mum who didn't have a car, didn't drive, and the weather was, as you can imagine, pretty bad, you know, in South Wales, a lot of the time.
Yeah.
A lot of the time was spent watching movies. And I, at a very young age, 4 and 5, remember watching Wizard of Oz, E.T., then going into things like, you know, my favourite things like Weird Science, and watching all these kind of 80s kind of cool films, movies, all this
Breakfast Club and all that, yeah.
Transport me
from
my... council estate, from my council flats, from my council house, it would transport me into these American dreams, you know, and it was, I don't know, it broadened my horizon, it made me think, it got me excited, and it got me performing, I guess.
Mm.
And that's where my roots have come from, is watching American movies as a child.
So you was like watching Weird Science, The Breakfast Club, St. Elmo's Fire, things like that.
There you go. There's me. You know.
Yeah, me too.
I had American Werewolf in London.
You know what? When I was a kid, I used to yearn to go to college in America or school in America.
It was just lovely freeing essence about American movies and what could be and what's out there. You know, young children, I do my very best and my children to introduce them because it's really important to take children to theatre. It's really important, even if it's a panto, right, every year. It's important to sit in a live audience and to see a live production. It's thrilling. And it's a lovely thing for an entire family to do together. It's exciting. And we do it every year. We won't miss Cardiff. We won't miss Mike Doyle in that panto every year. We love him. We think it's brilliant. And the kids love it, and they get used to going and sitting in a theatre and being part of an audience and learning a type of etiquette that you should learn and be educated about whilst being a theatre member, right? A theatre viewer.
Yeah.
And I think it's really, really important. And I was taken to, you know, the pavilion in Pushcall, and I'd see a panto and I'd bits and bobs, but I was never taken to see, you know, a play.
Okay.
And I remember, I think I was 14, was the first time I'd been taken to London, and we went to see Starlight Express.
Okay.
And it was just, well, it was otherworldly to me. It was unbelievable that this magic happened. You walk through these doors and you sit down, and this incredible performance was put before you. And it made me feel great and special and happy. And I felt at home. So again, these seeds are being planted, you know?
Yeah.
But it's all, you know, it's all about those movies, those 80s movies, and, you know, the big influences on me and why I do what I do.
Yeah.
Judy Garland, you know?
Yeah.
Incredible.
I guess, you know, your passion is there for theatre. I mean, you sound like, you know, it was a catalyst by watching these films and going to these shows when you were younger. But obviously, it sounds like you've got, I don't know, your love is there for the theatre in a big way.
In a big way. I mean, it's, you know, I can't, even to this day, you know, I've just turned 40, Carl. I still can't believe that I can turn around and tell
people. I can't believe you're 40, to be honest. I thought you were about 30-something, 32, 33.
Oh, well, you can come again. I'll be sending a fiver in the post. it is that thing. I can't believe that I've been blessed to work in these beautiful theatres and to have all these gorgeous scripts and to work with the people I've worked with. I've been very, very, very blessed. I look forward to the day I can go back to the RSD. I look forward to that. I look forward to the day to go back to the National. I look forward to doing a nice big contemporary play again back in the West End. That would be nice. But, you know, my babies come first, and I don't like being away from them. I get terribly homesick.
Yeah.
I miss them awful. So I wouldn't be in the right creative place.
Yeah, I know what you mean. I
know what I mean?
Yeah, I do. I mean, that's like what I do. I mean, I know these at my daughter's school, we've got the lady that played Nadine on that thing that was shot up in the valleys. Stella? Is it Stella?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I can't think of the lady's name. I should know, sorry. But she played Nadine.
Okay.
And she obviously has got a young daughter, and she goes to the school, but she's obviously working, you know, doesn't want to work in London, because obviously the family comes first. And you see it quite a lot. So, I mean, I'm glad, you know, that people put family first. Family's key.
Yeah.
But you do get some that don't. So, I mean, I'm not poo-pooing anybody.
No, I mean, it's the be-all and end-all for me.
Yes.
You know, it's everything to me. It's my world. It envelops me. And, you know, it's everybody's... Well, I hope it's everybody's spine. It's my spine. If I didn't have them, I wouldn't be able to do anything, you know.
Yeah, no, I do understand the same here. Gosh, I mean, we talk all day about families. I've got one question. Torchwood, obviously, that, you know, you must get asked the question about that all the time. Do you miss it?
Oh, I miss Torchwood like I miss sunshine.
Okay.
I miss sci-fi.
Yeah.
I miss, because that's magic.
Yes.
You know, it's, we do heightened drama and we create, you know, things that don't exist, and we challenge people's judgment of what's the non-fiction, and we create worlds and characters and fears and joy and love. Mm. And it's a beautiful world, you know, to be under that house, to be in under that roof of sci-fi. God, it was wonderful.
Mm.
Yeah, I miss it. I miss Gwen Cooper very much.
Mm. I mean,
I miss her staff. I miss her strengths. I miss her fearsome kind of brutal kind of fisticuffs. I miss the banter with the cast. I mean, we had such a great time. But we had 5 great years, and we continue doing audios, which I'm not saying so successful.
Yeah.
And if there isn't a day goes by that I don't get asked, there's a few. When is Belonging coming back?
Yeah.
When is Tortured coming back?
Yeah.
Well, if a day doesn't go by, I'd be shocked. it's incredible, you know. Sort of lovely shows, you know. I hope it stays with me forever. I'll love it forever.
But that, I mean, I guess that's your thing, though, isn't it? You don't want to become typecast in any role. You want to be known as a versatile performer, which you are, very, 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 very versatile. But obviously, there's a fear there that if anyone does something for so long, they become type. You know, they can become typecast. Is that always at the back of your mind when you were doing any roles that you've taken in the past? Do you know what I mean? It's like,
yeah, I think it would be really naive of me to say no. Because, you know, I'm a jobbing actor and I audition like everybody else. So I'm not in that privileged position where, of course, I've had some jobs just offered straight to me, but there are some actors who get that all the time. You know, some actors who don't get it at all.
Yeah.
And I'm a little bit in between, you know, I'm a bit in the middle.
Okay.
So, almost everybody's got to work.
Yeah.
Right? So you work and you put your all into it.
Mm.
But secondly, you know, if you see a pattern, which was happening with me maybe when I had the wobble, and I am a hard pattern to try and reverse out of, then you have to do something drastic. And, you know, I did something drastic. I learned Welsh and I went blonde. so, you know, it's, you know, aesthetically it was very different. Verbally, it sounded very different. And it's a different, you know, scenario of a story to be told. But, I think, you know, you've got to be mindful. And that goes for surely any path you take in any job. You've got to be mindful of your choices. We like to make tough choices, but we have to make them on a daily basis. Make them, live with them, do your best. Close the door and then start again tomorrow, you know?
It's like you said earlier, wasn't it? One door closes, another door opens. That's a good mindset to have. You know, you always learn by mistakes, don't you? So we've got to make mistakes to improve.
Absolutely. You know, I think, you know, it scares me the fact that people think that they don't make mistakes. I just think that's so boring. You know, make mistakes. It's about how you get up. It's like a boxer. You get hit down.
Yeah.
Not the punch. It's not how you fell. You'll always talk about that boxing, how he got back up on his feet and fought the rest of the round. And that's what you got to do.
Yes. I mean, where do you get all this from? Is this from your mum, I guess, when you were younger? She's got that mentality where it's always about just try.
I guess so, yeah, I guess so. I mean, I was brought up in a brilliant community.
Yeah.
A community full of, you know, ex-miners who fought all their lives.
Yes.
Worked all their lives,
yeah.
Working class, good, wholesome people who,
yes,
always when I go home now, always make me feel welcomed and loved.
Yes.
And brought up by people with a great attitude,
You know, got everything against them, actually, but with a great attitude and full of humour and full of fun,
yeah,
full of love. And if you've got that, I think, you know, you're going to be all right.
Yeah, I agree. Because, you know, salt of the earth people, that's where I come from, and Stoke, you know, the people, yeah, you don't have much, that's... but you make do what you've got, but you still make yourself a nice person, you know.
Play the cards that you're dealt.
Yes.
Be kind, man, be kind. It costs nothing to be kind.
No, it doesn't.
You know?
It doesn't. I mean, how do you? I guess you never go to any of these conventions for any of these like sci-fi things, do you?
Yes, I do.
You do?
Yes, I do, and I absolutely love them.
Oh gosh, okay.
Oh my God, it's one of those. It's like a stadium of loving. Is that Shit. What it is? It's full of people. There's newborn babies.
Yeah.
People in their 90s. I've met somebody who's 103 in America, coming to a convention, and he'd been going to one for years and years and years. There's families, there's couples, there's a husband and wife, there's, you know, there's bunches of friends, there's people who have met through doing these conventions.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a beautiful, beautiful world to be a part of. And you can go, and there's no nonsense, there's no hard feelings, there's no animosity or aggression in these places, in these conventions. It's full of love and fun, and people gathering together and discussing things that they really like. It's about people on a common ground who like escapism and like to explore it and talk about their passions. And I've been lucky enough to be in sci-fi, a couple of sci-fi series, and to be able to be invited to some of these cons. And we all get together, the casts all get together, and we have a great time.
It was just like when you said earlier about, you know, you're not a fan of the red carpet events, and I just wasn't sure how you... Is it because when you do these conventions, it's you're there playing a part, I guess? You know, you're playing Gwen or...
No, I can go and I can talk... The conventions, I can go and I will talk until I can talk a glass eye to sleep. You know, I can talk a glass eye to sleep about Torchwood, about Merlin, about Doctor Who, about Shakespeare, about all, you know, Broadchurch. I can, you know, without the script, because I'm talking about something that you know, matters to me, and it's I know an awful lot about. But when it comes to standing there and having, you know, photographs taken and what dress are you wearing and all that kind of stuff.
It's all bullshit, isn't it? It's all the, you know, the entertainment.
Oh, you frightened me, right? That's the deal of it. It's all that kind of stuff makes me very nervous.
Yeah. But at
conventions, I'm meeting people who've got similar, you know,
interests, I guess.
Interests in me. We're all there to talk about Torchwood, or we're all there to talk about that episode, or we're there to talk about film, or it's a completely different thing. It's work, but it's fun work.
Yes.
Like getting it, it's literally like walking into a room.
Yeah.
Normally you'd be there with like 10 of your best mates in school, but you're actually there with sometimes 10,000 people. And you're all, you know, I've got a microphone, there's 10 of us on the stage with microphones, and there's all microphones in the audience.
Yeah.
They're all asking questions, and it's a big party. It's such
fun. Maybe I should go next time then.
It's a lovely, you said you've got a little one, you should take your little one. It's such a lovely event.
I will do. I there's obviously the one in Cardiff, isn't there? And that
was
just,
the one in Cardiff is great. If you want to go, let me know. I'll get you tickets, whatever you need.
Oh, gosh, okay. No, I will.
You're not a problem.
Okay, yeah, I'll have to get your details. I don't know if I've got your details, have I? So I'll just have to Twitter.
No, you've got my number. Just drop me, just text me.
Oh, gosh, okay.
If you want to go to TardisCom, I'll make sure that I can get you in. That's not a problem.
Yeah, definitely. Oh, that'd be really nice, actually. Really nice. I was going to just ask you briefly, then. I mean, one moment. I don't know how long you've got or how long you can give me talking. Learning Welsh, how hard was it? Because I know that a lot of people will be interested to know how hard you found it, because I'm trying to learn Welsh. I know it sounds daft, but obviously, what was your methods? What was your approach to learning Welsh?
My approach was sit down and do it.
Okay.
No magic wand.
Yeah.
No clever way of doing it. No shortcut. There was no magic tonic I could drink.
Okay.
Unfortunately, that involved gin. I couldn't. You know, there's nothing I could do other than sit down and do it. And I did. I took the babies to school at 9 and picked them up at 3, and those 6 hours a day I would be studying.
How long did it take?
And that's what I had the first three scripts 3 months before starting, and then they were drip fed then through.
Jesus.
So sometimes I'd be filming, pick up at 6, yeah. and I'd come home at 7:30, and I'd go upstairs at 8:30,
mm.
and I would be studying till 1, and I'd get 4 hours sleep, 5 hours sleep, and I'd have to go again.
Jesus.
It oh. was, it was non-stop, but it's, as soon as you surrender,
mm.
and you give into it, and you go, this is how it is, don't fight it, get on with it, it's okay. It was hard. Very, very hard. Hardest thing I've ever done.
Yeah, yeah.
But also the most rewarding thing I've ever done.
Yeah, okay, okay.
I came out of it at the end and I went, well, I've done that.
Mm.
And, you know, I know there was a couple of people who thought that I shouldn't have done that.
Mm.
And I'm glad I've proved them wrong, because I think anybody who wants to learn Welsh and work in the Welsh media...
Need to...
And wants to learn the language, they have every opportunity and every right to do so.
Yes.
And we should be welcoming that and encouraging that and celebrating that, because what we want is to spread the Welsh language as far and as wide and as far as long as possible. So don't close doors, open them and welcome people in. Mm. That's my message.
I agree. I've got to learn it. I've got to. I'm trying to use Duolingo, so it's a start.
Yeah, good for you. Good for you. Keep at it.
And I will do.
Keep using it, and don't ever feel silly, I guess. I think that's my main advice. So anyway, don't ever feel silly for getting anything wrong. You know, there's no rights and wrong.
Mm.
There's helpful and unhelpful in the language, right?
Yes.
You're doing it. That's the main thing. That's the main thing. You're doing it, you're trying it, and you're experimenting with it. And the more you do that, the better you will get. It's like anything in life.
Mm.
The more you do it, the more you practice it, the better you get.
Yeah.
If, you know what the good help is having good people around you.
Yeah.
Boy, I have good people around me in Keeping Faith. I have the best people around me.
Mm.
You know, I was blessed, and I'm so grateful to them for their patience.
Mm. So there was a lot of assistance from them with some of the language then when you were filming, I guess, a little bit.
Yeah, they helped. You know, they helped all along. They'd run lines really tirelessly.
Okay.
You know, yeah.
Well, it came off. It worked. I'll say that.
Oh,
it did work.
Thank you.
But no, it's I could keep talking to you for ages. the only thing is I've got to type all this up. You know, one thing I will say, though, you would make a fantastic motivational speaker. Because the other week I went to see Ant Middleton, you know, the SBS guy, the Special Forces guy. I did a thing for Buzz for him, you know, big interview and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And he was fantastic motivational. And things that you were saying sort of ring to him with what he was saying, you know. So I know it sounds daft.
Oh, that's lovely. Oh, that's very nice of you to say. My goodness, thank you.
But it's like, you know, you are motivated, you know, and which is, it just goes to show hard work pays off, you know.
Yes, it does.
And dedication. Yes. Don't be knocked. Don't be told you can't do something.
It does, Carl. But you know, the catalyst of all that, it all starts with somebody saying to you that you can do it.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
It really does. You need somebody, and that person for me was Pip Broughton. She was the director and producer of Keeping Faith.
Okay.
She is the catalyst of all of this.
For Keeping Faith or before this?
Yeah, for Keeping Faith.
Okay.
She absolutely believed 100% that I would be able to learn Welsh.
Yeah.
And that I would be able not only to learn Welsh, but to smash the art out of Keeping Faith.
Yeah.
And you know, she gave me strength. And she gave me strength, and she gave me confidence every single day.
Yeah.
And there's not a lot of people like her about, you know, and I'm holding on to her with everything I've got.
Yeah. Does she speak Welsh?
Wonderful woman.
Does she speak Welsh?
She doesn't speak Welsh. Her husband speaks Welsh, and her two children speak Welsh.
Okay.
She lived in Monmouthshire for over 30 odd years.
Gosh, okay.
So she's our honorary Welsh lady.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
She speaks little bits of Welsh, you know, more than I did when I started, that's for sure.
That's interesting to hear, because, you know, she had faith in you to learn the language, but obviously she can't speak it herself, and, you know.
Yeah, she understands a lot of it, because people are fluent Welsh speakers and educated in Welsh.
Of course, okay.
So she understands a lot of it, but isn't a fluent Welsh speaker. It's really important to have that person there at the beginning to pick you up.
you know?
Yeah, I'm glad she did, you know? I think that's what, you know, I'm glad she did because, you know, you smashed the fuck out to the performance. So I, you know, I won't put
oh,
that
back, man, that, but, that means... I can't tell you what that means to me, girl. Thank you very much.
You know, I get to speak to a lot of actors and actresses, and, you know, and I think your performance, yes... and my wife, like I say, and a sister and a mother who live in England, they and everybody else, they always go on about, but you, you know, I'm good.
Get over it. It's, honestly, people ask me now, you know, and I still kind of fumble around for words, really, to try and explain how it feels when I hear things like this. Mm. I still feel a little bit kind of, I think it's shock.
Okay.
Really. We're all a little bit, me in particular, kind of going, I can't believe quite what's happened this last year, 2 years really, making it.
Mm.
And then it's going out in October on SOC and then smashing SOC and it's smashing BBC Wales and then smashing iPlayer, man.
Yeah, I know.
We just found out that we are the second most watched drama ever.
On iPlayer.
First is McMafia and Keeping Faith. Yeah. Our little tiny budget, tiny little big story set in West Wales is like the second biggest iPlayer drama ever. That is, I mean, it's unreal, right? And then on to BBC One,
yes.
Nine times.
Yes.
It's been like an out-of-body experience the entire year.
It must
but,
be.
But,
I mean, when you say about McMafia, I mean, I, without poo-pooing the director, I just could not get that, and I don't know how that was number one, but that's a different story. I mean, they had a massive budget. I honestly...
Did
not get that. It didn't go down too well either. Still, hopefully they won't make any second series. Because James is a good actor. I just think he was wasted in the role. But anyway,
it's funny. People say, you know, I've heard a few people say on reviews and they're going, you know, spent so much money on an eight part series. And I was like, we didn't even have money for cars in this.
Seriously?
Faith Howell's car in this.
Yeah.
Just said, oh, just use mine.
Get off. Seriously.
Yeah. is my director's car, right?
Shit.
Didn't have any money to get any vehicles or anything.
Bloody hell.
So when I'd come in to film in it, and I had loads and loads of driving scenes in it,
yeah.
I knew what Pip had been eating, you know, driving home. If that nice. There'd be like Red Bulls in the corner.
Seriously.
A Lindt chocolate, dark chocolate for energy. There'd be crisps.
Shit.
I know exactly what you've been eating. You've trashed my car.
Fucking hell.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, with the house then, your house in it, is that is in your house, is it?
No. They tried. I said, there's no way I'm on the crew in my house. You've got to be joking.
No.
I'm not having all those sweaty bastards using my toilet. No, I think if they'd asked, I would have said yes. They're such a lovely bunch. It's such a family feel to it.
Yeah.
Arwell Jones was the designer and designed with a little set. They designed that, the inside, the interior. But the exterior was used in lawn. And...
so that's the lawn, is it? The outside of the house?
It's in lawn.
Okay.
Yeah, and the couple who own it, Aenon and Mary, are the most beautiful, beautiful husband and wife. Oh, my God, they used to make me feel so at home.
Yeah.
You know, you're working at 4 or 5 in the morning, freezing cold some nights, and, you'd come in, and Aenon and Mary, they would have for me, they'd never let me drink out of a polystyrene cup, you know. My tea would always be poured into a teacup, you know.
Yeah.
And there'd always be chocolate biscuits for me. And, you know, Aenon would always say to me, you want a little gin and tonic, you? And I'd go, Aenon, if I wasn't driving, lines, I would take you up on that, you know.
Jeez.
It's so much so, you know.
Yeah,
we went down to Pendine on New Year's Day.
Yeah.
And on the way back, we have to go through Larne.
Yeah.
It's become a very special place to me down there.
It's beautiful down there.
And it has. It's become a part of my soul.
Mm.
And it's a very, very special place. And I called up to see them with some chocolates and flowers.
Okay.
And I popped in and they were in their dressing gowns. You know, I was about half a phone off. They were in dark and I popped in. And they were like, oh, come on in. Yeah, it's just lovely, you know, really.
Oh, it's
lovely, lovely feel. So, yeah, it's funny. It's funny that people don't realise that this entire programme, we made 16 hours of drama.
Yeah.
On not even a shoestring, I think it was an eyelid, you know. And poor Pip's car, man, is trapped. She went to go home one night and it was no petrol. She had to stay in it. She had to come and collect her.
Seriously?
She had to come and collect her and all of it. She was like, oh, don't ask.
That's comical. That's comedy gold.
It was a team effort, put it like that. It was a team effort.
So had it not been a drama, it could have been comedy gold. You know, you could have said that, the outtakes.
Yeah, it could have been, that's for sure.
Gosh. I mean, it's a good advert for Wales, though, the show. It's shown a lot of locations on the show. I mean, I live in Marcross, Nash Point. I know that you were shooting down here by the lighthouse. And it's a good advert for Wales. Was that... I mean, that's the last question because I can talk to you all night. Was that always in the script to find out the location, or is it like you just said, you just because you're on a budget, you just found places which were more. I mean, not approachable, I guess, financially.
Well, no, I think for you. Let's be honest, it's not hard to find beautiful places to film in Wales.
Oh gosh, no.
I mean, it's on your doorstep everywhere. Yeah. I mean, you know. It depends on what your idea of beautiful is. My kind of idea of beautiful. I love looking at the Talbot View. It's exciting, isn't it? It's beautiful.
Yeah.
Things like industrial things like that are really beautiful. And then you go along those Jurassic coastline, you know. Yeah. My God, it takes your breath away.
Mm.
I live, you know, I've just got a camper van because if I could live on or by the side of the beach for the rest of my life, I would.
Yeah, I think you're on Twitter, there was a picture of you in a camper van, I think.
Oh,
yeah, is that right? Yeah.
That's pigging shit. Couldn't be happier. And, you know, rocked up on Saturday, we took the kids on to parties on Saturday, we took the woman in the van, was on the thing, and we just went, right, come on, off we go, and down to Barry we went. Overlooking, you know, the pedals and watching the planes come in and
sit
down with the beat. It's just fab. but it's, you know, it's really very beautiful.
It is.
I've been quoted, I don't know how many times, a quote where I said, you know, people go, wow, that's CGI, and it's not CGI. It's just Wales, if that was. And, of course, you know, I think that Larne and that coastline, that Carmarthenshire coastline down there, plays a huge character in the show.
Yes, yeah.
I mean, it really gives it an identity where it is. It gives it that kind of ethereal, where is this? This is an odd little place with colourful houses and a big beaches and where something really bad has happened. And yet it's so pretty and elegant and almost kind of romantic.
Yes.
And it has that Dylan Thomas kind of spirit running through it, you know.
It's a beautiful place. It is a beautiful place, especially at night when it's dusk, you know, and it's just got a lovely feel to it.
Yeah, it is. It's really, really beautiful. But, you know, technically when it comes down to it, we had one of the best DOPs. You know, Steve Laws is, you know, a magical, wonderful, talented DOP who... he and Pip work together, you know, like surgeons, they're incredible. So they knew what they were doing, they know how they wanted to look. But it was important to us first to represent our country in a modern sense. We wanted Wales to look modern, to feel modern, to represent modern people, but to keep that really strong sense of tradition, the warmth and the love. The welcome and the tiley, they say, the family. But you know, to give it that kind of aesthetic that could transcend worldwide.
I understand.
You know, we've had people worldwide going, where is this? It's beautiful.
Yeah.
And it should do, because Wales is beautiful.
It is. I mean, like when you watch things like Hinterland or Hidden, which are very, very not much darker, but they don't portray, like you say, a modern feel to Wales. They're very, very farmland, North Wales, you know.
It's very rural.
Desolate.
And it's very kind of agricultural. Yeah. And that's also a really interesting, you know, ethereal, kind of mystical kind of land also. And I think, you know, the way they shot that and the way they filmed that really served the narrative that they were telling.
Yes.
Served it beautifully. I mean, you couldn't shoot that really where we shot Faith, I don't think, because I think it would jar with what they were trying, what they were, the world they were creating. But I think it served our story and it served the freedom of our story. And it really gave you an essence of these people are very much of the land.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, it's, you know, of the three, your shows, it's got more of an international feel to it, if that makes any sense, you know, appeal.
Oh, thank you very much.
You know?
Thank you very much. That's very, very, very complimentary.
Yeah, it is. I mean, how long was the shoot for Faith, then?
Was it what?
How long did it take to shoot it, film it, you know, you said?
We shot, I think we started in April and we finished, I think we finished the end of November.
Well, so
then I went straight into, because I was filming by the end of it, it was clashing with a very English scandal. So yeah, it was in November.
Yeah.
Oh, right,
yeah.
It was a long shoot,
a
very long shoot.
Oh gosh, it sounds, yeah, but
hot summer.
But you're doing Welsh and English obviously you know, at the same time, so.
Exactly.
Oh gosh, yeah. gosh, okay. I could talk to you all night, but I need to start typing this up. So it's going to be in print, obviously. I think I've got 2 days to get it done.
Okay, good luck.
but there will be an online version, which will be longer, much longer.
Okay.
Because obviously the print magazine, you know, as you know, a buzz, you've only got one page, but for the online, I've been given free reign, so I will get, maybe not the whole hour, but we spoke about quite a few things.
No worries, Carl. That's lovely. Thank you ever so much for your time.
No, thank you for your patience with the telephone signals and mobile signals and all that.
Well, don't worry, not a problem.
But we live in Wales, don't we? So we learn to.
Accepted, move on.
but I'll once it's online, I can always message you or something, you know.
That would be great. That would be lovely.
But yeah, okay, lovely. And I hope to get to meet you in person at some point soon, anyway, maybe at the BAFTAs.
Yeah, that would be lovely. Please, give me a tap on the shoulder.
Yeah, I'll come see you at the BAFTAs, because I think I'm going to be the man for that anyway. So I'll come and say hello. I know you might be hiding somewhere, but yeah.
Possibly.
Not with blonde hair in it either.
There might be a little gust of wind, and you go, she's gone in.
No worries. Okay, wonderful. All the best. I'll speak to you again. Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks, Eve. Bye-bye. 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 Bye-bye.